the King's Troop Royal Horse Artillery about to fire. They weren't renamed the Queen's Troop. There's the bell firing, the hammer on the left of it. They weren't renamed the Queen's Troop. Queen Elizabeth said they should be called the King's Troop in honor of her father. And the same thing is going to happen. The Queen's Company of the 1st Battalion Grenadier Guards, who are the closest escort here for Her Majesty's coffin, are going to retain the name the Queen's Company in honor of Her Majesty. Two of the Queen's corgis, like Emma the pony, Sandy and Mick. The Queen was famous, I don't know how many corgis she had, 50 or 60, I think, in her life. But they've been brought out here just to the right of the arch as the cortege comes into the quadrangle, the private part of the palace. It'll go round and be joined by the King and members of the royal family at the state entrance. Familiar figures by now in this procession. King on the left, Princess Royal, the Duke of Kent, Prince Edward on the far right, the Duke of York in the centre, not in uniform, Princess Royal and the King coming out, the Duke of Sussex behind, the Duke of Gloucester behind him. And Vice Admiral Sir Tim Lawrence on the far right. The male members of the royal family and the Princess Royal. The other female members of the royal family will travel by car down to St. George's Chapel, not march in this procession. Prince of Wales towering above Princess Royal, Duke of Sussex passing through, Peter Phillips there, and the Earl of Snowdon as well in this procession. They're going through the archway of the Norman Tower, and that will take them round to the left and down the steep hill into the, what's called the lower ward of the castle, which is where St. George's Chapel is. the lower ward, the lower fortification, historically. There's a lower ward, a middle ward, and an upper ward when this place was first fortified. Procession is on its way down towards the west door of St. George's Chapel, and there there'll be this very simple service of committal, all agreed with Her Majesty the Queen, much discussed, the service taken by the Dean of Windsor, and it contains psalms, the Russian Kentuckian of the departed, hymns, a reading, a bidding, prayers, more hymns, and then the committal itself, with this coffin being lowered in front of the altar until it disappears from sight. And the Queen's piper will play a lament, and the Garter King of Arms will read out the styles and titles of the Queen. And the regalia presented at the coronation will be removed and put on the high altar. And the Queen's company camp collar will be placed on the coffin by the King, and the Lord Chamberlain will break his wand in half and put it too on the coffin, everyone standing in silence as the coffin is lowered. The Dean of Windsor will say the committal from Psalm 103, and then the well-known words, "Go forth upon thy journey from this world, O Christian soul." Final blessing, as everyone stands, will be given by the Archbishop of Canterbury. A very simple, straightforward, moving ceremony that brings the Queen's body to lie beside the bodies of her mother and her father and her husband and her sister in the George VI Chapel, newly built on the side of the St. George's Chapel. The hearse enters the Horseshoe Cloister and stops in front of the steps that lead up to the west door of St. George's Chapel. And the bearer party will come out from the right. These young men who have carried this coffin from Westminster Hall, carried it down the aisle of Westminster Abbey, and now for the last time will carry it up the steps into St. George's Chapel, where it will, at the end of the service, be laid to rest. The Earl Marshal and the Lord Chamberlain precede the coffin up the steps in loving and devoted memory. The pallbearers on either side, whom we saw coming up the long walk, precede the coffin. The royal family stands waiting, they'll follow it into the chapel. the bearer party, their last duty done, departs from the chapel, and the royal family take their place at the east end of the choir with the coffin of the Queen on a catafalque before them.
We have come together to commit into the hands of God the soul of his servant Queen Elizabeth. Here in St. George's Chapel, where she so often worshipped, we are bound to call to mind someone whose uncomplicated yet profound Christian faith bore so much fruit. Fruit in a life of unstinting service to the nation, the Commonwealth, and the wider world, but also and especially to be remembered in this place, in kindness, concern, and reassuring care for her family and friends and neighbours. In the midst of our rapidly changing and frequently troubled world, her calm and dignified presence has given us confidence to face the future as she did, with courage and with hope. As with grateful hearts, we reflect on these and all the many other ways in which her long life has been a blessing to us, we pray that God will give us grace to honour her memory by following her example, and that with our sister Elizabeth, at the last, we shall know the joys of life eternal.
Reading from the book of Revelation that was read at the funerals of the late Queen's father and her grandfather, George V.
I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sin. And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people. And God himself shall be with them and be their God. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. And there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain. For the former things are passed away. And he that sat upon the throne said, Behold, I make all things new. And he said to me, Write, for these words are true and faithful. And he said unto me, It is done. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give unto him that is athirst of the fountain of the water of life freely. He that overcometh shall inherit all things, and I will be his God, and he shall be my son.
Remember, O Lord, thy servant Elizabeth, who has gone before us with the sign of faith, and now rests in sleep. According to thy promises, grant unto her and to all who repose in Christ refreshment, light, and peace, through the same Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Merciful Father and Lord of all life, we praise thee that thou hast made us in thine image, and that we reflect thy truth and light. We give special thanks for the life of thy daughter Elizabeth, for the mercy she received from thee, and for the example that through her life of service, love, and faith, she has set before our eyes. Above all, we rejoice at thy gracious promise to all thy servants, living and departed, that we shall rise again at the coming of our Saviour Jesus Christ. We pray that in due time we may share with our sister that clearer vision when we shall see thy face in the same Jesus Christ our Lord.
O Father of all, we pray to thee for those whom we love but see no longer. Grant them peace, let light perpetual shine upon them, and in thy loving wisdom and almighty power, work in them the good purposes of thy perfect will. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. O Lord, support us all the day long of this troublous life, until the shades lengthen and the evening comes, the busy world is hushed, and the fever of life is over, and our work is done. Then, Lord, in thy mercy, grant us safe lodging, a holy rest, and peace at the last, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Lord God Almighty, King of creation, bless our King and all members of the royal family. May godliness be their guidance, may sanctity be their strength, may peace on earth be the fruit of their labours, and their joy in heaven thine eternal gift. through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. God save our gracious Sovereign and all the companions living and departed of the most honourable and noble order of the Garter. Amen. As our Saviour has taught us, so we pray. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
And now the congregation stands in silence as the instruments of state which were received by the Queen at the coronation are received back by the Dean of Windsor, who places them on the high altar. the scepter, which was received by the Queen as the ensign of kingly power and justice. The orb, the globe of the world, which she received with the words, "Receive this orb set under the cross and remember that the whole world is subject to the power and empire of Christ our Redeemer." And finally, the imperial state crown, which the Archbishop of Canterbury placed on her head in Westminster Abbey with the words, "May she be filled with abundant grace and princely virtues." everyone remains standing before the committal. But first, His Majesty the King receives the small Queen's Company camp colour, which is used to identify the whereabouts of the commanding officer. And he places it on the coffin. The Lord Chamberlain, the most senior member of the household, his duty done, breaks his wand of office and places it there too. And both will be buried with the coffin.
As a father pitieth his own children, even so is the Lord merciful unto them that fear him. For he knoweth whereof we are made, he remembereth that we are but dust. The days of man are but as grass, for he flourisheth as a flower of the field. For as soon as the wind goeth over it, it is gone, and the place thereof shall know it no more. But the merciful goodness of the Lord endureth for ever and ever upon them that fear him, and his righteousness upon children's children. Go forth upon thy journey from this world, O Christian soul, in the name of God the Father Almighty, who created thee, in the name of Jesus Christ, who suffered for thee, in the name of the Holy Spirit, who strengtheneth thee, in communion with the blessed saints, and aided by angels and archangels, and all the armies of the heavenly host, may thy portion this day be in peace, and thy dwelling in the heavenly Jerusalem. Amen.
Thus it hath pleased Almighty God to take out of this transitory life unto his divine mercy the late most high, most mighty, and most excellent monarch, Elizabeth II, by the grace of God of the United Kingdom of Great Britain and Northern Ireland, and of her other realms and territories, Queen, head of the Commonwealth, defender of the faith, and sovereign of the most noble Order of the Garter. Let us humbly beseech Almighty God to bless with long life, health and honour, and all worldly happiness, the Most High, Most Mighty and Most Excellent Monarch, our Sovereign Lord, Charles III, now, by the grace of God, of the United Kingdom of Great Britain and Northern Ireland, and of his other realms and territories, King, Head of the Commonwealth, Defender of the Faith, and Sovereign of the Most Noble Order of the Garter.
Go forth into the world in peace. Be of good courage. Hold fast that which is good. Render to no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the afflicted. Honour all people. Love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen.
Thank you.
as the organ inside the chapel thunders Bach's Prelude and Fugue, the king takes his farewell, speaking to the Archbishop of Canterbury, the king so clearly moved by the service, particularly the end where he laid the standard on the coffin and watched the coffin lowered into the ground, into the vault below. The King's departure, the committal service here at St. George's Chapel has ended. The Queen's coffin, which has been seen by so many thousands over these past days, lowered out of sight into the vault to lie later alongside the coffins of her husband, her mother, and her father, and her sister. Many tributes have been paid to the Queen over these past days, some of them public, but many, many more by voices unheard, people talking among themselves, talking to their family and friends. There have been tributes to in services across the land,